जय हिंद, दिस इज ब्रिगेडियर हेमंत महाजन वेलकम्स यू टू अ सेशन ऑन इम्पॉर्टेंट एस्पेक्ट ऑफ नेशनल सिक्योरिटी, दैट इज फाइटिंग हाइब्रिड वॉर अगेंस्ट चाइना. पेट्रियोटिक सिटीजन, हाउ दे कैन हेल्प द कंट्री फाइट अ हाइब्रिड वॉर विच चाइना एंड पाकिस्तान हैज लॉन्च्ड अगेंस्ट इंडिया. आई टेक दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू थैंक श्री पीयूष सुरैया फॉर गिविंग मी एन अपॉर्चुनिटी. I will talk on this subject for about 15 to 20 minutes. Thereafter, if there are any questions from people who are attending it, we will take on few questions. The questions can be put on the chat box, or you can send the questions to Sri Piyush Suraya and then he will send it to me by on the WhatsApp. We will definitely take on some questions. So, China's hybrid war against India and how is India countering it, that is what we are going to talk about. I will also use some PowerPoint slides in between to show you certain maps so that you understand the subject better, and thereafter we will end the session with some interaction. Okay, now this is what I plan to do. Now let me start by saying that the nature of warfare is changing. I repeat again, the nature of warfare is changing. What is happening now is, if you look at the history of warfare, India became independent in 1947. We fought the first war with Pakistan in 1947-48. It was the conventional war fought over 1 year. Second war we fought was with China. It was for 4 weeks in Himalayas in 1962. Third war was fought with Pakistan in 1965. That was over 3 weeks. Today we celebrate the 50th anniversary of winning the Bangladesh war, which was the greatest ever military victory won by the Indians. Now, by the Indian Army in particular, this war was also a conventional war in which Indian Army fought the Pakistani Army, and the role of normal common civilians was very limited. The war was basically fought on the border with conventional weapons. The last conventional war that we fought was in 1999, that was the Kargil War. It was a very well televised war. These were all conventional war. But after losing the war in 1971, Pakistan realized that it could not take on the Indian Army in a conventional war. So what they did, they started an unconventional war which they called as Operation Karakoram. Operation Karakoram was launched by Pakistan in 1972. It consisted of three main aspects: K1, K2 and K3. K1 was Khalistani terrorism, K2 was terrorism in JNK or in Kashmir, and K3 was terrorism in rest of India. Khalistani terrorism in the late 80s, we all are aware of it. It was finally crushed by the Indian Army with the help of Punjab Police. K2 Kashmir was a very quiet area. It was a paradise till 1970s, but it became a violent area after 1980s, in which Pakistan infiltrated terrorists, its supporters, into various political parties, into the bureaucracy, into the police also, into the NGOs also, into the media also. And Kashmir is the Kashmir proxy war is still going on, though it is now under control and restricted to only few districts of the Kashmir Valley. Now after this was the war which they started off, terrorism in rest of the country. Mumbai blast, we are well aware of as to how bomb blast kept on taking place at regular intervals in 1993 and thereafter. Thereafter, the 26/11 attack took place from the coastline, and that is well documented, well known. So these were acts, various acts of terrorism. Now what happened was, in 2014, a government came into power which was proactive against terrorist activities carried out by Pakistan. We carried out a surgical strike in Myanmar. We carried out a surgical strike when Pakistan did a terror act in Pakistan itself. Surgical strike too was an air raid that was also carried out. So this was all was done. Now after this was done, China realized that if it wanted to contain India, if it wanted to stop India's progress, then it must do a different kind of a war. And this is what has actually started off few years from now. You can say 2014-15 onwards, they started a war which is called as the hybrid war, or it is called as the gray zone warfare, or it is called as a unrestricted war. How does this war differ from other places? How is it different? Very briefly, when technology was dominating warfare, when the USA fought a war in Iraq with the help of technology, missiles, aircraft, etc., China did a lot of research and it said, we will fight a war called the unrestricted war. What does unrestricted war mean? Unrestricted war means that we will carry out war against our enemies by every possible means. The only rule of unrestricted war is that there are no rules. And this war is not only against the armed forces, but it is against common citizens. Not only that, this war will continue 365 days a year, and we will fight India or rest of the world on all kinds of platforms. Now, how exactly are they fighting it? I will come to it in a very short while. But it's a war against people of the country. So therefore, every citizen of the country becomes a soldier. Now, how is it being fought? I'll very briefly tell you as to what all China is doing. China is taking Pakistan's help to fuel terrorism into India. It is making Pakistan come up as a proxy against India. It is its basic aim of the hybrid war is to ensure that there is always a violence in India. There's always some insurgency or terrorism going on in India, so that India economy does not prosper. If there is no terrorism, start agitationalist terrorism, start having bunds, start blocking roads, as was done in Delhi for over a period of so many months. The roads was blocked and it was the economic blockade of Delhi. So firstly, using Pakistan. Pakistan's activities in India are well known. I will not get into too much of details. Let us talk about other activities. It is helping the Naxals or the Maoists who are operating against India in the central part of the country. Okay, that is second. Then there is an insurgency which is at low key, which is taking place in the northeast part of the country. Now, in this insurgency, China is helping the insurgents to carry out lot of activities of destruction, firing. And you will remember that some time back, an attack took place on 46 Assam Rifles, and thereafter, the CEO, along with his wife and along with his very cute child of 6 months, was killed. Not only that, they provoked when a 21 para special forces was carrying out operations in Nagaland. In an unfortunate incident, instead of terrorists of Nagaland NSC and K coming there, it happened to be some laborers who were coming back. But what happened thereafter was highly anti-national. Some of the groups in Nagaland tried to make it into an incident as if army has killed people in cold blood. No, it was not. It was just a wrong intelligence. But also remember, in this area, the while there is a ceasefire, the terrorist groups are greatly involved in smuggling, they are greatly involved in illegal trade, they are greatly involved in carrying out extortion in various states such as Nagaland and Manipur. The government of Nagaland is not willing to stop the extortion. It is not willing to stop the smuggling. It is not willing to stop the illegal trade. But it wants to sort out the Indian Army by carrying out, by removing Armed Forces Special Powers Act, which gives legal protection to the army. So this is this kind of a disinformation campaign, this kind of a propaganda, this kind of a psychological war is going on. So insurgency. Then you have China carrying out a border standoff in Galwan, etc. It has been covered quite well. China carries out a psychological war. It keeps on telling you, we got a very big army, we got a lot of tanks, we got a lot of aircraft, we got a lot of disruptive technologies. So you kindly listen to what we are saying and do not carry out any action which will annoy us. Kindly sign on a dotted line and ensure that you agree to whatever we are doing. Obviously, we can't do it. So we have a border war. Then they carry out what is called as the cyber war. One would remember that sometime back in Mumbai, there was a cyber attack which took place on the electricity grid. Now Mumbai is an economic capital of the country. When it gets attacked, when the electricity there stops, obviously what is going to happen is that the economic capital is going to suffer, internet will go down, and today everything is so network based that we can really stop a country's progress by carrying out a cyber attack. Now there are thousands of cyber attacks which are taking place from China. Of course, we are trying to protect ourselves. Now thereafter, they intrude into our neighboring companies, such as a neighboring country such as Nepal, and they try to turn them against India. They talk to Bhutan directly to resolve the boundary issue, and they are putting pressure now on Bhutan to make them sign on the dotted line and make Bhutan accept an agreement by which Doklam will go to them. They get into Myanmar, support a regime which is against its own people. They get into Sri Lanka and they wanted to build a solar power station right next to the islands of Sri Lanka, which are next to the Tamil Nadu coast. They are trying to get into Maldives, trying to put them under into an economic subversion. China is carrying out an economic war against India. Initially, it was economic subversion, but now it can be called as an economic war. What are they doing? They are flooding. They are only wanting to export things to India, but they do not accept anything from India in return. And today, despite trying for a few years, our government is still not able to get out of the clutches, because there are a large number of people in this country, in the corporate world, who believe that you cannot live without China. So therefore, this subversion of Indian economy, they have been responsible for more or less killing the small scale sector industry, the middle scale sector industry. Now there is a lot of illegal trade that takes place through the containers. There are some Indians who cannot be called as patriotic. They show a voucher of saying that we have bought things worth 1 crore into India through containers. However, what comes inside through the ports of the country, that is the Mumbai port, the Jawaharlal Nehru JNPT port, or Calcutta port, or Visakhapatnam port, is goods which are much higher in value. So since you are paying taxes only on 1 crore, the other goods can be called as smuggling. China floods our neighboring countries, especially Nepal, etc., buy a lot of Chinese stuff. Now, who buys the Chinese stuff from Nepal? Nepalese people, not so much, but the Indians who go as a tourist there buy all the Chinese stuff and come back. So that is how they are subverting our system. They are trying to get into our corporate world and trying to subvert us Now, Government of India has decided that any investment coming from China will be looked after very carefully. So China started following the third country route, that is coming via Hong Kong, coming via Taiwan, coming via Singapore. So basically, they wanted to take hold of the India's technological sector. What we must understand is India is very strong in some of the technological sectors, especially in the area of software. So they wanted to get into Bangalore, which is also called as the Silicon Valley. So they wanted to get inside that. But now we are trying to stop them. China is also carrying out what is called as the legal war against India. Now, what does it exactly mean? What they, one would remember that sometime back, there was a corporation called Vedanta, who used to produce copper in Tamil Nadu, in Chennai. The Chinese paid some money to the local unions and told them that you start agitating, go to the court and say that the Vedantas are producing copper, which is polluting the countryside. So High Court was made to give a ruling that stop the production of copper by Vedantas. Now, how can you stop copper, which is required as a basic material in the country? Now, High Court, without understanding, gave away this ruling and said, stop this factory. Now, who benefited? Now, we are importing copper from China. We are importing copper from Pakistan. Doesn't our people understand that by using laws of India, we are trying to stop certain factories from coming, and that's how we are subverting the economy? Are the copper factories not running in China? Are the copper factories not running in Europe? They are running. While pollution did not be there, but other things can be taken care of. Another form that they use against India is what is called as the agitational terrorism. And one very good example is what happened in Delhi. The so-called farmers were agitating. Now, they had blocked two roads. Well, anybody has a right to agitate, but do they have a right to block the roads? What we must understand is, in any Indian city, take an example of, say, Pune, there are just 5-6 roads which come to a city. For example, one road comes from Satara Sangli, one road comes from Mumbai, one road comes from Solapur, one road comes from, say, Saswad, etc. Now, if you block two roads, then everything that the city requires comes from outside, be it fresh vegetable, be it milk, be it grains. Whatever is produced in the industrial estate of the city has to go outside. Now, that can't go outside. It is said that when two roads to Delhi were blocked, what was the effect on Delhi? You kindly go to any economic newspaper and type out in Google search economic losses due to blocking of roads by the farmers of Delhi. 4,000 to 5,000 crores of losses were occurring in Delhi every day. Every day, I repeat. The kind of a damage that was put on India by this agitational terrorism was tremendous. Tremendous. I repeat it again. Now, this is called the agitational terrorism, and Supreme Court has given a very clear ruling that nobody should block the roads. But unfortunately, the implementation is very, very lethargic. Governments are scared because of vote bank politics of stopping this kind of a blocking of roads, etc. Now, media is also highly subverted. They will keep on talking against the country. I'm talking of Indian media. The Indian media can broadly be divided into three parts. That is the electronic media, the TV channels in Marathi, Hindi, regional languages and English who give news. Then you have the print media who publish news in all the languages. Then you have the social media called the Facebook, called the Twitter, called SMSs, emails, WhatsApp, and so on and so forth. Now, a lot of disinformation campaign takes place there, trying to say that India does not have a future. I repeat, India does not have a future. Now, for example, during the Galwan standoff, there's a constant disinformation campaign that was going on against India. No, Chinese have got their modern tanks there. This is what the Indian media said. Chinese have got their tanks on the border. Now, they did not report that if the Chinese tanks were on the border in Ladakh, so were the Indian tanks. But that was not reported. Chinese have got modern aircraft on the border. Yes, you mean to say our aircraft were whiling away their time in Mumbai or in Pune? No. Chinese have got artillery guns. Where are artillery guns doing nothing and sitting in Devrali or Nashik? Chinese got their microwave weapons. Chinese super soldiers. Chinese soldiers could do anything. Chinese have deployed what is called as a hypersonic weapons. Now, everything that the Chinese were doing, there was an equal reaction from India, and we were more than adequately prepared for carrying out any action against China. Now, when the Galwan Valley clash took place, the Indian media only reported that 20 Indian soldiers were martyred, including Colonel Babu. But what was not mentioned was that 70 soldiers of China were also martyred. This was reported by USA, this was reported by Russia, this was reported by many other countries. But Indian media decided to talk like a Chinese media and only tried to tell us that Indian soldiers were martyred. No, for the first time, the blood of Chinese soldier was also shed on the international border. The last time Chinese soldiers shed their blood was in 1978 war against Vietnam. So, disinformation warfare. So, this is called gray zone warfare, hybrid warfare, multi-domain warfare, etc. And in which the Indian people are the target. So, what do we do as an Indian citizen to counter this? Whatever the armed forces are required to do, they will definitely do it. We should have faith in our armed forces. But what should we do as an Indian citizen? Firstly, all of us are cyber warriors. All of us are information warriors. If a wrong message comes to you about the country, about, let's say, the Indian army, kindly do not forward it, because there are at least 150, 200 Chinese or Pakistani agents in our media, on our social media. There are a large number of websites who try and tell people that what Maoists are doing is right, what security forces are doing is wrong. Disinformation campaign is launched in the form of websites, in the form of WhatsApp messages, in the form of YouTube. Kindly do not see them. Kindly, if at all it is completely against India, they're trying to spread rumors, then that link should be sent to cyber police so that they can investigate as to who is doing it. I'll just give you an example. In the present case, General Bipin Rawat, when he was injured in a helicopter crash, there were some people, anti-national people, who started announcing from 12:30 onwards only that General Rawat was no more. Well, the government of India had not announced it. This kind of disinformation being spread is very morale lowering. We should take action against India. There are some people who celebrated the death of General Rawat and the 12 other soldiers who were martyred with it. Of course, they celebrated it on the WhatsApp, they celebrated it on the YouTube, they celebrated it on the Facebook, they celebrated it on the Twitter. All such, if you notice anything of this nature, this link should be sent to cyber police so that we can take action against them. Because the most important issue is the social media is vast. It's like an ocean. So suppose if somebody talks anything against our country, we should not forward it to anybody, but we should keep our eyes and ears open. If you notice an anti-India website, anti-India WhatsApp account, anti-India Facebook page, anti-India emails, SMS, kindly send it to the cyber police so that they take action against it and catch these people. We should all become information warriors. That is one aspect. Should not forward any information which is not verified. Next issue is we should try and help the country in our day-to-day life. I'll just give you 10-20 things as to what we can do. There is a shortage of water in the cities. So we become water warriors and help the country in water security by saving water. Help the country in food security by buying vegetables, milk, etc. directly from the farmers. This way, the farming community will be helped. Try and buy things in a digital manner. Do not pay wherever you go. Do not pay money in cash, because the moment it is digitally paid, what happens is that the money goes to the bank, and the shopkeeper or a professional, say a doctor or a CA or anybody, wherever you have to make a payment, the digital payment goes into his account and he has to pay income tax on that. There are a very large number of people in our country who do not pay income tax at all. So therefore, that is a very bad thing to happen, and we must ensure that everybody honestly pays taxes, because today, if the country has to prosper, if we have to make our economy, our armed forces stronger, we require government to have income, pay your GST honestly, pay income tax honestly, make digital payment, try and go in for electrical vehicle, whoever are using vehicles, because that will stop the pollution, that will help our environment. Try and use solar panels to generate your own electricity. This will help the country in energy security. Try and use electrical vehicles so that you do not use fossil fuel, which are creating a problem of carbon dioxide. There are a lot of good things government is doing for the poor people of the country. It is Ayushman Bhava Yojana. Suppose you have somebody with you who do not know this Yojana, try and help them out. Government is giving loans to small people for carrying out businesses worth 1 or 2 lakh rupees. There are n number of things which government is doing, but it does not reach the people who are supposed to benefit, so educate them. But the most important part where you can help your country is ask yourself, yes, to what can you do for the country? Don't keep on asking, I want this from the country, I want more DA, I want more this, I want more that. Now, whichever field you are working into, try and become world class in that. If you are a student, you should become world class like Arjuna. If you are a teacher, become world class like Dronacharya, who is supposed to be the best teacher. If you are a scientist, be better than Dr. Abdul Kalam. If you are an entrepreneur, become better than Microsoft, Google, or anybody. If Indians can do well and become CEOs of top 500 companies like Google and IBM and Facebook and all, why can't the Indians show the same amount of capability where inside India? Why should they be working there, working only in the foreign countries and trying helping Europe or America or others to prosper? Well, their brains, their effort is required here. So become an entrepreneur, become a startup person, become the best farmer in the world, become the best in the technology. There are so many things one can do. The most important is, whichever field you are working into, kindly become world class so that our economy prospers, so that our comprehensive national power increases, because this hybrid war with Pakistan and China is going to continue for many years. Unless we unite as a country and activities which are positive, the country is not going to progress. Do not take part into any violence. Do not take part into any agitations. Do not take part into drugs. Try and ensure that whomever youth you know, he doesn't get victim of drinking, smoking, and such like things. So there are, if you are a senior citizen, try and become a mentor to younger people. There are n number of things which you can do. What it simply means is, if you are an experienced person, utilize your energy, your leadership, your capability to help out the other Indians, so that India as a country becomes world class. That is the only way to win this hybrid war which is launched against us by China. What the government should do is a different subject. Government is by and large doing what it's supposed to do. Armed forces are by and large doing what they're supposed to do. But we as a citizen have to ensure that our country becomes world class by prospering in whichever field we are working into, we should help the country to become number one in that field. I think I will end here. I'll see if there are any questions. I'll just have a look at the WhatsApp. Otherwise, till the time I look at the WhatsApp, I would also tell you that this video will also be put on the YouTube in a short while, it will be available to you. Maybe you can share the link with whomever you want to. Let me see if there are any questions that are there. I find that there are not too many questions right now. Let me go to the chat box to see if there is any questions here. Chat box is also not many questions are there. There are, of course, lot of people have tried to say very good talk, we like it, etc. What all that I will tell you, somebody said Jai Hind, somebody said Bharat Mata Ki Jai. So I am happy that the national spirit has been achieved, and today the whole nation is mourning the death of General Rawat. But this national spirit, this patriotism should be used for something constructive. That means prospering, improving in any field where we are. All that now remains for me to do is try and share this video, if you have liked it, with as many friends as possible. Send the link on the WhatsApp, and very shortly I'll put it on the YouTube, and I'll share a link with Shri Piyush Ji. Try and share it with as many people as possible. Jai Hind. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. Jai Hind once again.